Welcome back to your broadcast, as we are here to bring you Cena Cup Season 5, our Law Bracket, second match of the day. And it's Ly Gaming going up against LV Gaming. We had a bit of an interruption when we started up our broadcast for this matchup, as everyone seemed to disconnect out, and then Dota 2 seemed to fail, as we couldn't launch for three consecutive times. But we are launched now, we're getting ourselves underway, the draft's already begun. I can welcome in my co-caster for today's matches, and that is Pandago. Welcome to Game 2.
Thanks for having me back again. Good to be here.
It's good to have you here, man. It's good to have you here. So I don't like Super, though. I do not like this Super. The other Super in VG Gaming, I'm fine with. But this one, bans Enigma first, I do not like.
It did it just to spite you, I'm sure. There was a Viper ban in the last game before everyone left, right? Or was I just imagining things? I think they had a Viper ban, so I don't know if that was like...
everything was broken because the ban was on the wrong side.
Oh, all right.
So it was like, we had first pick, we had first ban. Ban whatever the hell you want to. Yeah, so it didn't count. Yeah. But we kicked this one off without the Viper ban up. Instead, they'll take out Krob and Lycan for against Light Gaming, and the Enigma and the Razor against
dire
LV.
Team pick.
But LV seemed to be pretty heavy on the initiation, as both Centaur and Batrider will arrive. Little uncommon to see both these heroes being selected, unless you're casting a Chinese game, at which point we are, because they run a core Centaur, a number one role Centaur, and then the Batrider for the offlane.
So yeah, they have, I mean, LV Gaming, assuming that is a core Centaur, which running as a support is like super uncommon. They are really invested in just getting pickoffs and kills because, I mean, well, the game I was playing right before I started casting this, I lost to a Centaur, and this was a Nell, and he had 3 hearts by the end of the game. So I was going to say, Centaur is not a really strong carry, but I guess if he has that kind of farm, any hero is going to be a strong carry.
I don't think we could really class 3 hearts as, like, legit build in any competitive game.
Because
if you get to that point, then you're not finishing the game when you should have.
I mean, we had a lot of farm too. It was just a really long game. I mean, he didn't go like straight 3 hearts. He like eventually worked his way. Actually, he had 2. He said he could have bought the 3rd one, but he didn't. He bought it like, you know, as the game ended. So it said he had 3 hearts, but I digress. Enough about that last game. But what I was going to say is like that lineup, they need to basically end the game early or at least get a huge advantage in Snowball, because if they don't, then... like, they don't really have really strong farming potential, and their heroes don't do a lot of damage past, like, their burst between, like, you know, the double-edged center combo or Batrider trying to lasso someone in. So they definitely need to get something done early game or they're going to have a lot of troubles. And they can't really push towers too effectively either based off of those 2 heroes. I mean, that can change.
Reserve time.
Well, Ly Gaming, they're off to a fun draw so far. I'm going to be skeptical about what could end up happening with heroes in this game. Just because of previous experiences. But at least they have the ability to take out both Skywrath and Doom from LV picking up, one by them picking up Skywrath and the second by banning out the
Radiant
Doom. So Brewmaster should have a little bit more space to play around in this game. Even though, obviously, Centaur and Batrider are 2 fantastic initiators, and they do have some nice burst damage coming out from the Centaur already, without even looking at another core hero yet. But I would be expecting
Radiant
that Brewmaster to have a little bit more freedom coming into this game. And some interesting bans now. SD as well as the Tide. I wouldn't have liked SD as like an instant ban, even though I know like he's pretty damn good up against the Batrider. But there's still a lot of other heroes you can pick up against the Batrider.
Dire team pick.
Unless it's meant to buy time. Like, if Brewmaster being initiated on by the Centaur, and you get the disruption off, you have to wait, and then he'll instantly pop out in the split. And that would cause you a significant amount of problems. And a Shadow Shaman? I don't mind the hero, but right now I would prefer something more like a Rubik. Or something that's able to help counter up against the Centaur Stampede.
They really don't have too much, yeah, to deal with that, but they can definitely still pick something else up that, like, they don't have to have the support to deal with the Centaur ultimate. And, I mean, if they can sort of... Brewmaster, if he, like, initiates on someone, that is a way to kind of deal with it, because a lot of those heroes are going to need a center ult to get out of that initiation, or if even if they get Skyrath slowed, like they're going to need to use it defensively. So if they can, like if Ally Gaming can force LV to use a Stampede defensively, then their heroes are going to be really well off. This is another one of those games where like the initiation is very key. Like whichever team gets the better initiation or who gets the jump is basically going to dictate the fights. I mean, unless of course they're like diving into awkward positions, like what happened last game. There was a lot of awkward dives where even though they were getting initiations, they weren't like, you know, with a proper one that they should be taking. Chikuru, I mean, that gives them push power for sure, so. And they definitely need it, because I think they need a way to take some early towers so they can snowball their lead. Even if they're getting kills, if they aren't able to, like, take any towers off of that, then, Alright, so, if assuming that Centaur is a core, then they have their, like, three heroes.
Yeah.
Or LV Gaming's, like, got their cores at least.
Yeah. And it will be. Unless they pick up Nature's Prophet to go with the Batrider. Don't do it. But yeah, it should be Invoker in middle lane, Centaur, Safe Flame, Batrider up on the top, then Jakiro, just a basic support hero, and he can combine up on with anybody in any lane. They can even go for a jungle hero themselves if they wanted to. Their pushing power is actually quite low here from LV. Like, I know you got Jakiro, who's like wonderful for pushing down towers with chip damage, but you're going to need a little bit more if you're going to try and force the towers. Especially up against a lot of arcane harassment, potential mass serpent mods, and Brewmaster causing chaos every time you look to push as well.
Yeah. Assuming Invoker goes Exort, though, they do have the Forge Spirits as well, so I think between Liquid Fire and like just Forge Spirits, that's pretty high damage on towers. Morphling, that's interesting. But I kind of like that. They're really just sort of like solidifying their late game advantage. Light Gaming is going to have a really good time this game if LV can't get something going early. Remaining. And just, like, if they don't get their blinks going on Centaur and Batrider, and if, like, really at, like, the right timings and get pickoffs with them, then I like that AA ban too, obviously, because it just destroys Morphling. But if they don't get, like, the ball rolling, LV Gaming is going to be in trouble. And Light Gaming has, like, Panda ult to fight early with. They have Shadow Shaman to take the towers. Even though they don't have, you know, super push, I mean, Shadow Shaman is by himself strong enough, but he can also use, like, they have the dire Shadow Shaman advantage, so he can just basically kill Roshan early game with a Brewmaster tank or something and get Morphling in early Aegis. So, Light Gaming has, I think, the easier, like, lineup to execute, and if LV doesn't get the pickoffs that they're looking for, they're gonna have a hard time.
But if LV does get the pickoffs they're looking for, then the Morphling's not really going to transition into what you want him to be. There's going to be no damage coming out from him. The Shaman will become food. And, well, you know what I was saying before, man? Where you can't be comfortable and instantly know what they're going to be picking up. Well, we get Nurse of Warrior up from LV Gaming. I will assume this guy's a jungle. I will assume he is going to the jungle. I don't know what he's really meant to be doing here. Because they don't have perfect control over the Brewmaster.
Honestly, like, this is the type of game where I could see Centaur support being a decent thing. Light Gaming, like you said, they don't really have that much to deal with the Stampede. But that hero, like, he's good if you get a fast blink and you can initiate on people, but you don't really need to do that. Like, they have the Batrider for initiation, so he can get the blink, and you can just use Stampede to either lasso people into your team, even before you get a 4 staff, or you can use it to just get away from Brewmaster ult. And then you have, like, the ability to transition. I mean, they basically have, obviously, I mean, he can still transition into a pretty strong hero if he gets a blink and he gets, like, return and he can farm with the Tranquil Boots still, so it's not like he is just, like, a worthless hero even if he plays as the 4. So they can go either way with this. I'll be really surprised if they just start with, like, a jungle Ursa. They could also do that, though. I mean, they could, like, have the Ursa pull and kind of try and transition him into a farmer. Mm-hmm. But yeah, this should be a really interesting game. I like that. I like the... They definitely needed a... Like, their last pick had to be some sort of, like, carry hero, or a hero at the very least that could transition into one, like a Wraith King or something along those lines. And Ursa will certainly do that. It's really good against Morphling.
It just seems to be getting heavy. that's okay. That's okay, because they're running a Core Nature's
Prophet. We're confident that that is a Core, yes.
It's a Core Nature's Prophet, unless they're going to start running Super as the Skywrath Mage Core.
But no, I think the lanes are pretty... So do we know which... I actually don't know who LV, like which one plays which role. And Flame, I know that one, but which one's the support and which one's the carry player usually for...
The only one I'm remembering off the top of my head is DDC support. Like, that's it.
Yeah, and but, Flame is mid.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we're pretty confident Barrier's off lane, so it's just we'll see. I mean, probably based off the item choices, we'll be able to tell what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I like both these drafts, though, and I think this will be a really good game. Like, as long as the teams aren't too aggressive and make some greedy plays, like, it can go either way off of this draft.
Something tells me, man, both these teams will not want to be aggressive early on. There's too many items which you have to, or levels
yeah,
you have to
wait
for.
They're going
to
want to farm, yeah.
It's like Skywrath Mage is going to get a couple levels and zone him out. Shadow Shaman needs his level 6. The Brewmaster wants to get Blink Dagger and Arcane Boots and also have level 6. The Morphling needs to get a lot more farm. And then, Nature's Prophet. Very self-explanatory. Whoa. He needs money. So, what do we actually get as far as item builds?
They got double stout. They both have stout shields. How am I supposed to know now?
You can never know. Judging by the fact that Demons is still walking around with 6 tangos and he shared 2 of them, I'd say Demons is going to go jungle with this. I don't know if he's looking to rush bottle because he's still got 125 gold up his sleeve. He could be looking to rush Morbid Mask. But that's another way you can approach this Ursa in the jungle. But ZYF is moving back and you've got DDC also backing up.
Oh, they blocked it.
Only one of the camps though.
Yeah, I mean, I think it'd be a little too obvious if they try to get all of them. They just want to get Vision down here, because they have Nature's Prophet still, so you can, you know, annoy them.
I think we're getting dual lanes. I think we're actually getting dual lanes. The Prophet to go off lane, with Super as a Skywrath Mage, and then Brewmaster up on top with a Shadow Shaman. That leaves mid solo, XDD, taking up the role as Morphling. Well, LV will have Lin on the off lane as the Batrider. Inflame, Invoke, middle lane, begins. No surprise. DDC, he'll be down here in the bottom lane with Demons, and they're the two supporters, and the core will be the Centaur.
And I think that will definitely still work, because they can just form a quick blink on Centaur, and then they have so much threat around the map with Bat and Centaur blinks, and then the Ursa can kind of just farm it behind it. And if they can control Roshan with those blink daggers, then eventually they'll be able to take the Roshans with Ursa. And he can just sort of catch up that way. So, I mean, he's still going to be played, and, you know, obviously as like a core hero, it's just... And yeah, he is starting in the jungle, so this is interesting.
Lin, how aggressive do you want to be with Boots first? Straight into the Firefly, not even waiting for Sticky Napalm. He got Ether Shocked once, Ether Shocked twice. And he's very lucky he doesn't get clamped up by that Brewmaster, or potentially... Actually, this could... No. One more shock and he would have been dead, but he got out of vision of the Shadow Shaman. On the way to safety.
So,
what were you saying about not being over aggressive? Not getting too greedy?
Yeah, I mean, he knew he didn't have the. He Ether Shocked him once, so he was able to sort of go in, but that was kind of. As long as he doesn't get clapped, though, I think he knew he was pretty safe. It was pretty close, though. This dual offlane is actually really strong against the dual safe lane of LV. Jakiro and Centaur both have a really hard time with Skywrath, and he has boots so he can like kite them around really well and just harass them out with his Q. And Nature's Prophet's getting a lot of farm. So it's gonna slow down like the free blink of Centaur. Whoa.
Yeah, Morphling's able to claim it up there. I thought it was gonna be Batrider as he was diving in very, very deep up on the top lane, but somehow Morphling is capable of getting a First Blood and Invoker, but Invoker didn't go a single point up into Quas. He went Sunstrike and now lands in the middle lane. But he didn't have a single point up with the Quas, so no Quas now for protection and no extra strength. That wasn't the plan. Regeneration. I'm assuming you missed that one too.
Yeah, I completely missed that. I did not expect any kills to be happening in that lane at all. Even without Quas, I don't really think he should die there. But I'm assuming he was probably just trading hits with the Morphling, got too aggressive. The Morphling just went in on him and managed to take him out. I mean, it was kind of close. It's not like he just, you know, got right-clicked to death or anything. The Morphling got away with barely an HP, and he might have even morphed after the kill, so he was probably, it was probably like a one-hit kill difference, and that's the type of stuff where I feel like LV Gaming doesn't need to be taking those risks. They just need to try and get their items faster than like gaming in the lane and like by CSing and then just fight with the blinks. They do see this Skyrath and they're pinging him out. I don't know. Maybe
they can't kill him. Demons is too busy currently farming.
And he's super fast. I mean, he has boots, so.
Actually, Inflame can give it a shot with Forge Spirit as well as the Call Snap damage. He can't invoke up a Sunstrike, and everyone else is too far away. Like, he could attempt the Sunstrike in 11 seconds. But knowing exactly where Super is moving, if he hits that, then it's going to be next level Invoker play. For now, ZYF's getting forced off the lane. Actually, leaves DDC in the lane as the Jakiro.
Yeah, this is wild. They have like these three heroes that all do well with levels and farm, and they're just sort of like, oh, we'll go jungle when we can, just run around. But I like it, it's interesting. The Batrider is having the biggest trouble right now, like out of all these heroes, and I think he's the one that actually needs to like get prioritized farm. And then also the other problem is when you have like a jungle support Ursa thing like this, you're not stacking for him at all, and he's gonna have a harder time doing jungle. Morphling, diving again, but not getting the kill this time.
Just slipping around.
Just trying to harass, yeah.
He found himself in a little bit too deep. That's why just wave bomb back out again. He just went over the tree line. Safest and quickest way to freedom. Demons, he's in trouble. Caught out on the top rune area, and Tranquil Boots will not protect him here. And with the haste straight over on the wall.
That was kind of questionable. If he had a clap there, like, I mean, he shouldn't have it as a jungle Ursa, but if he would have had it, he could have gone for it. Oh no.
Yep, Inflame's in trouble. Call Snap, but the waveform already coming out from XDD. He has switched the Force Spirit over, but I think he lost the tracking on him for a moment, which gave XDD a little bit more space. A nice rotation coming in there from Super. They go 3-0 now on the board.
And those are, like, big kills, too. It's opening the lanes up a lot. I mean, two of those kills are mid. One of them's a solo kill, so it's not like it's just, you know, like a support dying in a weird spot. I mean, I guess Ursa is a support, but still. He really needs to, like, snowball, and that's not how you want to be doing a jungle Ursa.
If I was LV right now, I'd be really, really concerned about that Brewmaster Blink Dagger coming so early on. He's already at 1,500 gold. And which means initiation galore is going to be coming in, and the Invoker can't stop that kind of stuff. In fact, there's no one that really can. Because you don't have any kind of silence hero, and if you're thinking that you're going to have, like, a centaur blinking into a hoof stomp as like a counter initiation and Brewmaster, that's not really going to happen. And a Batrider is nowhere near the point of being ready to be a counter initiator, let alone an initiator himself. With only Tranquil Boots approaching level 4, but like Shadow Shaman's keeping the same level almost as this Batrider. And he's actually got, I want to say more farm, but he's pretty close to a concussive shot. The orb attacks as well. Brewmaster can't get in range for the clap. But they'll shock and force the Batrider out and profit. He TP's in and locks Lin in the corner. Flamebreak will bounce him around. But they ensure the kill, and they just profit's cracked level 6 now. Including getting his Wrath of Nature up. And he might trigger it right now. If he triggers Wrath of Nature, he can get the kill. He had to trigger on the bottom lane when the initiation came out from XDD, but it would have bounced in and should have been enough damage to kill off that Invoker.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Well, the center is getting close to Blink. The one thing they do have to deal with the Blink Panda is the Stampede. But, oh, actually, Panda went Arcanes over the Blink. I thought he was just going to go straight Blink because he was at like 1400 or 1500, and you definitely expect that. But
yeah,
maybe that's because they have the Stampede to deal with it. Because you can't really, like, rushing a Blink really quickly isn't that important if, like, you can't go use it right away with your ultimate. But with Arcanes, he's able to farm it much more effectively. Like,
there's your Stampede. Super, concussive shot's going to go onto Demons, but they're going to come point-blank range on Super with the Sunstrike to get the kill, but the Prophet ultimate with the clamp. There goes your split, so the Hoof Stomp does nothing. They'll lose the Ursa, they'll lose the Centaur, they'll lose the Jakiro for the Skywrath Mage going down. As far as the other lanes as well, Morphling is coming very, very close to Inflame. But he won't be able to get close enough to get the kill, but either way, they don't lose the tier 1 tower like gaming. And LV get punished for diving too deep and Inflame. Well, Call Snap. Just tower attacking. XDD has to stop him. DP support's coming in, but Inflame can't reach him. The Sunstrike. XDD don't walk in a straight line. He's got one charge and bottle charges, however. The ice bar's too far off. And now concussive shot and orb damage. Inflame, the TP came in from XTT. Not enough damage to actually get himself a... Not enough mana, to be able to pick up the Sprout, but the damage output with the secondary orb. Batrider actually kills with the Shadow Shaman in the meantime, but DDC, popping up the salve, saving his life there in the mid. But they'll lose the tier 1 tower.
Whew. Yeah, that was, I don't know why Inflame, like, walked up when he was just, like, the only thing he had left in that fight was Sunstrike. There's no way he should have, like, walked back towards the Morphling. I mean, you're gonna kill him with the Sunstrike, you're not gonna kill him, so don't keep chasing. But...
Brewmaster, a little bit of trouble. Ursa started attacking, he's already down to 300 life points, and, well, DP support from the Shadow Shaman will keep him safe. There's no split, so they're trying to force the issue, but there was also no lasso for the Batrider. Speaking of which, yeah. He hasn't leveled that up yet.
He just, yeah, that's kind of weird. But, like, that dive bottom was the type of thing I was talking about. They can't use Stampede offensively like that because it is
speaking
the only
of dive,
thing.
Oh, he's got no Tango. He can't cut free. He tried to go for the Hold Stomp, but he's Stampede. He triggered it to run away, but the Sprout remained. And there was nothing he could do about it. Also, Nature's Prophet, 8 minutes in, 9 minutes in, has Blade Mail with his Face Boots and Null Talisman.
That's pretty unique. You don't usually see such like a low HP Nature's Prophet Blade Mail build. He doesn't have, usually you go Power Treads or at least get a few Null Talismans. He only got one. But I mean, I guess
I've
actually
been
so
seeing
far.
This more and more, man. Like,
really?
Yeah, it's been a lot more popular. It's normally when you try and be a little bit more proactive in your lane, however. So if you're trying to win the 1v1 matchup, then you go into the phase boost and you get the double Null Talisman. Middle lane, clamp the split DDC. There's your Hex coming off from the Shadow Shaman with the extra shock damage. He'll shackle up DDC in the tree line to ensure that kill. While Demons, he'll die the orb attack of Super. The Horb Stomp will be able to hit. But Super's got a lot of support around him, including that Brewmaster. And to get the Sun over on Limb, the Sprout's going to hold him there, which means the physical DPS will be available. One hit from the Brewmaster, and we go 13-2 on the board. Light Gaming will be retreating now because most of their stuff's back on the cooldown. But they are so far ahead. You are 10 minutes into the game at almost 10,000 net worth advantage and 7.5k experience advantage. And they're going to take the tier 2 tower in the bottom lane. Denial from Inflame, but XDD, he has a lot of damage there. The Horb Stomp's going to miss, which means the control is gone apart from the Cold Snap, but Prophet Ulti comes in, and then a quick Strength Morph by XDD. Yes, he started his TP and then cancelled his TP, but one charges, bottles up. He's got Waveform available, but he won't be going in on that Centaur.
Holy moly. Yeah, he had 2700 gold. He's 5-0 on Morphling, and they have all these towers. What did he even buy? Is he just getting, he's just going Lincolns. Now they're taking Roshan with their Nature's Prophet Rasta combo to get a, like, 10-minute Aegis for their Morphling. It's a 10-minute level 11 Morphling that has 5 kills and 2-3 towers, even though one got denied. Yeah, I don't know what LV can do, because like I was saying, Light Gaming has like a stronger late game, and LV really needs to like get the ball rolling with their Blink Daggers and get pickoffs to have a chance, because they can't really farm effectively outside of like getting pickoffs and taking towers and then farming the map after they've taken control of most of the map. And at this point, it's like every hero on Light Gaming can farm pretty much anywhere, actually. Like, they don't have to be too afraid, especially since they still don't have blinks. Like, Centaur doesn't have his blink, and Barrider still don't have blink. So LV is in a dangerous spot.
I think that's a
understatement.
Yeah, you're making it sound so nice.
I'm trying
nice.
To make it sound good. Thank you.
You're such a positive guy. I actually can't believe how positive you've been today, Fandango. Normally you're that.
I'm trying.
Yes, you are. I appreciate
it's very
it.
Hard.
Demons is gonna die right now. Wrath of Nature doesn't do as much damage, but he gets controlled by the trees. And then XTT's just like, well, I have Blade Mail. What are you really going to do? Yeah. You can attack him, you have Morbid Mask for a little bit of lifesteal. But the Ursa would end up killing himself if he attacked. Look at the top 3 net worth. 6.8, 6k, okay, now we can change all of that. As they're probably going to get another kill. Centaur ult is gone, Super getting Call Snap, Hoof Stomp, but now XTT comes in. The Sprout goes in Inflame, the Ice Bot's going to be there too with the Macro Pyre, but they're going to burn up themselves, maybe not. Yeah, maybe they will. Major's Prophet moves back, he will actually end up dying to the Chikiru tick out. But Jakira is spinning up in the air. All three of his cores are currently dead, trying to use the Fog of War. But Morphling waveforms in, one attack with the Brewmaster swipes. And this Mass Serpamore's pushing in the tier 2 towers. This is 19-4, 12 minutes in. And I almost want to just like find some kind of white tower and throw it.
Games I've seen in a while.
It's not too fun. The most one-sided game I've seen recently was Tongfu's game. Not the one from today. They got destroyed. I think that was VG Gaming versus Tongfu.
This was all off of that bottom dive. I mean, they really wanted that kill on Sarath, but is it really worth it to dive with Sarath and kill him? And like, they didn't have a guaranteed tower off of it. They were just too aggressive for that tower, and that's how a lot of teams are like screwing up lately. Is they get baited in when they like really want to get these early towers. So if you can bait them and then counter with like a TP, and they had the perfect hero to do it, a panda with arcanes. Like, he didn't have a blink yet, but you don't need it when the enemy team is stuck behind your tower. Mm-hmm. They use Stampede to initiate, and it's just like he got a double clap and cleaned up three heroes, and that took him from like 800 gold and arcane boots to
profit.
I think he had like 1500.
Never got the blade mount turned on. Morphling's gonna come in right now, but he's low on life, and it's Drake morphing up. In comes the Brewmaster. The Mystic Flare's gonna destroy demons. And XTD instantly up to 2.2k, waveforms down. They have adaptive strike to stop the TP out by DDC. Man, this game is done. This game
keep
is
in mind,
Morphling so
still had Aegis too, so even if they did kill him there, it's like, oh. Alright.
There it is, GG. 14 minute GG. Games were good, games
sometimes
were quick.
Yeah.
And the day will be. The day is not over yet. But for a while, at least, we'll be dropping the live stream. We have a bit of a break. We have a bit of a break coming up. So the next Cena Cup game is scheduled to happen. I believe the semi-final actually got a little bit postponed. Only by half an hour or so. But we will be having HCT versus VG Gaming at 13:30 CEST. So that is 19:30. That is 19:30 SGT time. So all Chinese time or Singapore time, however you want to look at it. So that is going to be coming up later on today. You can also tune in to Basekip. He's going to be doing the coverage for Join Dota, doing the MSI Beat It qualifiers. I say qualifiers, sorry, the main event. The qualifiers for Beat It is actually over. But the main event of MSI Beat It will be coming up starting at midday. So this is 2 hours away. They'll be over on Join Dota Blue, so you can enjoy the action over there. For now, thank you very much, Pendego, for joining me for a short but sweet game. I hope you enjoyed it.
Yeah. At least the first one. I was hoping the second was going to be better. Like, I liked the drafts, and I was like, yeah, this game might be good. The first one was, like, okay. And then, yeah, you can always be surprised with Dota. Thanks for having me, though. Yeah,
it's been wonderful, man. It's been wonderful. Thanks for watching, everybody. VODs of all the games will be available at youtube.com/joindota. And in the meantime, I will wish you a very good break, and I'll see you in a couple of hours.